John Hardy, 1 against the Mighty Yellow Rage. 0-1-31-79. Wild. 1854-1900. Dear Oscar was a darling for a day. In fashion with the fawning, fickle press, who later laughed his dignity away, unsaw his soul unbutton and undress. The once delightful dilettante was stilled. His unborn epigrams aborted in his mind. His future poetry and plays each killed. His fancy faltering mute, deaf and blind. For Oscar's art was not enough to check his masochistic challenge of propriety. So into Reading jail they locked the wreck of Oscar Wilde, whose wit once fluttered free. In tears and blood he scribbled and he scrawled. The butterfly that once had flown, now crawled.
I'm trying to get a red to be in this movie.
Arthur Rackham,
beautiful hair.
1867-1939. Arthur Rackham lived to draw. Observe the dreamy things he saw. In his fate, fantastic brain. Elves and fairies, sprites and trolls. Giant birds, huge rabbit holes. Yet the man himself seemed sane. Modest, mousy, very plain.
Modest, mousy,
green and
very
burnished
plain.
Brown, embroidering an elf queen's gown. O'er the foggy English skies. Looming somber up above. Moody colors children love. And their parents prize as well. Rackham's visionary spell.
Rackham.
0808-78. Arthur Simmons. 1865-1945. Ethereal as Soho candlelight. Behind the foggy NFEATAGRED window pane. Lurk Arthur Simmons' decadent designs. Poems, paling like a yellow haze to white. As all their pastel tones dissolve in rain. The storms of time that curtain and confine. The poet's soul, unblot each precious line. And yet you glimpse his ghost in Drury Lane. Languid like a vagrant vagabond. A misty phantom faded to remain. Forever flickering, in and out of sight. For Arthur Simmons lived behind, beyond. This muted, modern age, amid the fond. Yellow 90s aesthetic yesternight. 0330-80. The Isle of Torturers. After Clark Ashton Smith, the silver death was ravaging the realm. Of Yoros, slaying with a silver agony. Except for young King Fulbra at the helm. Of his blackened royal barge, adrift at sea. And later he was cast on island sands. Imprisoned by fierce natives who enjoyed unspeakable sick pleasures with their hands. King Fulbra's flesh was tortured with, untoyed. They tempted him with hope, and then withdrew. All promise of escape once proffered him. Redoubling all his suffering anew. Until all faith inside him died on him. But when they seized King Felbra's magic ring, then silver death smote torturers in King. 0317-79. Haunted Heritage. For Mike Ashley, primeval campfire bards intone their tale. Of fairyland, where human beings dare not stray. A nether realm of waters bright and fey, evoked by incantations in the banshee's wail. From out of ancient balladry, man's myths prevail. As legends from a far gone pagan day. Evolve, and make their immemorial way. Down centuries, old ghosts, old magic, cannot fail. They live as fiction on the printed page, to thrill a reader on a winter's night. In some Victorian book, shelved by the bed. Such phantoms mock our glib, computer age, where even science cannot point the light, to drive the cosmic specters from our head. 1973. Hadrian's Wall, revisited. Grimstones still undulate across green land. Mute monuments to legends passing on. Imperial Roman eagles, rusted, gone. Before barbarians, slaying with a hairy hand. Squat-painted savages rose in a band. Against the sentries on the fortress wall. Top of standards, banners, each to fall. Forever, Caesar's empire could not withstand. There looms another siege-racked wall today. Poets standing guard, with bureaucrats below. Whose sharpened pencils for their sanguine spears. The ladders rise, defenders join the fray. As boiling oil is spilled in scalding flow. But walls are breached, poets pierced. No one hears. 1125-82. Immortal bouquet. The withered arm of time has plucked the blooms. That crown the brow of love and rent the ring. Of roses, round love's head, decay consumes. The petals, powdered gray flecks everything. The shorn of blossoms, love's skull draws. Its scalp in wrinkles it retract. And Titan, the first of all time's loss. Would seem the last as well, the fatal fact. That life means death, yet death becomes rebirth. Love's phantom sheds its flesh and rides the sky. Below, its skeleton sinks deep in earth. The gnarled old arm of time grasps high, but cannot seize the cloud as it encloses. In silken mist, gold ruby roses. 0806-85. Progress, too. Modernity has ravaged golden thrones. The kings are toppled, ornate crowns displaced. That roll and ring upon the palace stones. Decapitated, those heads the crowns once graced. Unsevered, all the links of language with the past. Dumb, unlettered beasts, we grunt and snort. Among the vine-choked, fluted pillars, No words last. Antiquity's philosophies abort. Inside the wordless moon of now, we swine. Have overthrown the ruined emperies. Bort us crude, we rope, barbaric and bovine. The parchments all are shredded, smashed, each freeze. Of carved Hellenic majesty, we root. Amongst the marble rubble where we shoot. 1989. The treatise song. Renewal, Easter. April love, rebirth. RAC, archetypal terms for when. Fresh shoots begin to green the thawing earth. Unfill with sweet cliches this poet's pen. At least I know what spring is not. The cruelest month's not April, no. In spite of Mr. T.S. Eliot, whose spring and soul were both of snow. But he was young. Age brings surcease. On spring, forsythian daffodils. As flowers on its sprout increase. Undecorate the rain's well drills. Thus, in the landscape of my autumn rain, the hues of yellow and of green remain. 032383. Eternal balladry. I hear the songs of working people played by three-piece bands, sung far off-key. In taverns, with electric amplifiers turned up high. Or at the mountains where the tunes have stayed. Changeless, for 200 years of song. This Anglo-Celtic minstrelsy can never die. So long as mandolins and fiddles cry. Their plaintive songs of true, true love turned hung. Of God, on ghosts, on deaths and birth. On square dance reels where clapping couples throng. Upon the oceans, on the plains, there, the songs are made. For people close to water, dust and earth. Where love and grief give music all its worth. And where the troubadours ply their timeless trade. 1982. Lamia. For Michael Fantina. The lady bade me linger for a while. Beside the cypress in the burying yard. She fetched me to a graveside with her smile. And set me on a marker cold and hard. She smiled. It all comes down to this, you know. That kings and merchants, each the same. Will sleep as brothers is a marble row. Till mosses blanket over each proud name. I shivered. Mid-November air breathed chill. And I looked down at my watch. The hour was 8. I said, however much I'd like to listen still, my appointment schedule in the village cannot wait. She smiled, and begged my pocket knife from me, then carved my name upon the cypress tree. 04-1880, Reverend, 12-1090, Buddhist monk. Unsullied by the world, with conscience free, he sits in contemplation, hour on hour, of one small point on his anatomy, from which he gathers strength and mystic power. Not for him the hero's wide acclaim, the soldier's glory, nor the merchant's prize. Deaf is he to trumpetings of fame, blind to the promise in a woman's eyes. For him no cleaving to ephemeral things, no ties to trap his feet in tangled ways. That snare the steps of diplomats and kings. No fear of blame, and no desire for praise. Supremely blessed, the holy Lama sits, heedless of bombs that blast the world to bits. 1974. Retribution. The table was running with ale. The wizard was starting his tale. The barley-drunk swordsman slouched near. And tore at some dry hunks of bread, and scowled as the sorcerer said, come close and listen in fear. But they only glared at their beer. Their leader unslung his long blade, said, you're the one should be afraid, and severed a head that went thud. The story remained never told. The warriors pushed north in the cold. Next spring, they're found frozen in mud, their hair matted, smeared with black blood. 07-11-78. The Armageddon Hour. As children playing with a dangerous toy, who think it's sport to make the toy perform, no matter what it will soon destroy, and maim the innocent in fiery storm. So men of might, in momentary rage, under cover of enforced democracy, let loose upon an unsuspecting age, the curse reserved to scourge humanity. Not quite content with their appalling deed, they vie with Woden, ape the mighty Thor, and toy with thunder that will surely breed, raging whirlwind whipping flames of war. When men make playthings of so great a power, the times portend the Armageddon Hour. 1978. The Witch of Prague. After F. Marion Crawford, the wan and weary wanderer arrived in Prague, in search of someone lost from him. Dear Beatrice, whose love for him once thrived, but now diffused in daydreams, misty dash dim dash dash. The days were damp with dark and doom. Instead he met that siren mesmerist, Unarna, seductive, subtle witch who drew the wanderer to her within a tangled tryst. She pulled him backward through the centuries, exhibiting the horror in the graveyard gloom. But still he spurned her wanton witcheries, aware that yielding only promised doom. At last his Beatrice returned, once more. And lost Unarna vanished, out death's door. 032380. Am I my brother's keeper? Of course not. I must walk aloof, alone, and clutch my dear possessions close to me. Pomp and power, prizes I've sought, and won. And since I have no brother of my own, I have no one to keep or help, you see. Each man for himself, that's how it's done. And help I ask from anyone is none. At least that's how I've tried to make it be. Until suburban chilliness stills my heart. And I grow sick of living inwardly. Discovering my neighbors aren't made of stone. Chain link fences can't prison us apart. As cautiously our nervous voices start. Exchanging greetings in that iced unknown. 02-2080. Christmas symbols. November casts its leaves in days away. The calendar's last, best, page remains. December. And our losses and our gains. Are summed across a sky of frigid gray. Forgiving sins from some far August day. Our slate scrubbed clear. The month now wanes. And yet behind December's sleeted panes. There crackles warmth, an ancient mystery play. Its symbols are the holly and the scented pine. Humility, not vanity, at end of year. And peace to our trespassers and our friends. The English mistletoe, the gift of yours and mine. And carols that poor sinners, like ourselves, most hear. Then, manger ward, a band of seers wins. 1982.